down. Listen, man.
Anybody got any weapons, any knives, anything?
Flag you off. Go through a machine and it's gonna take care of everything.
Damn, I gotta leave my dick out.
What did he say?
He says no weapons. I got to leave my dick out.
So slow, the soul of time I spend within the cell of mine, the cell which is the shrine of crime, the cold, the dark, the alone. Shadows fall upon my floor. Cast now, cast forevermore. By cold steel bars and high steel doors. Summer nights, the whispering ways of birds in flight. No, see the sun, celestial light, where
child alive.
are you doing? You're trying to start something. Yeah. Look, I had one cigarette when I come in the cell, right? That's what I'm smoking now. I mean, what's the big deal?
Well, you better smoke and smoke, sucker. It's got to last you all night. And I'm going to do it one year with one more cigarette than anymore anyway.
The Night Owl Show, Fridays at midnight on Channel 6.
I spend my life here. I've been spending my life here. In fact, the last 11 years I've been at Greenhaven. My case has gone through the courts three times. There's been three trials. I've been incarcerated for the last 13 years. I've claimed my innocence from day one. In addition to the three trials, I've taken two polygraph tests just recently at the request of the lieutenant governor. But essentially, the issue, what happened was, the case went to trial three times, and the reason it went to trial three times was because the jury, which is supposed to get the facts and make a determination based on fair and impartial facts, never got the full facts in the case. And therefore, they weren't able to come to a proper verdict in the issue. A lot of the evidence that should have went before the jury never reached the jury because of rulings during the case. And that's what I've been appealing in the courts. Now, the case has been controversial in the courts. It's been, I've got a split, what they call a split court in the appellate division. Two judges went one way, three judges went the other way. There was a dissenting opinion in the Court of Appeals. The Court of Appeals a few years before reversed and ordered a new trial. So it's been a controversial case all along.
Well, if someone had sat me down and said, you know, would you do this? I don't think I could have done that in one shot. It was the cumulative effect of knowing him for years and years. You know, seeing a person, how they react in many different kinds of situations, what their values are, what their beliefs are. It's because I knew that he was really a stranger in a very strange land of prison, and I could see over a long period of time that what motivated him and what how he perceived his situation and how he dealt with it was really extraordinary. And we, in our friendship, we learned from each other a great deal. And even when I started feeling like, you know, he started to touch my heart a little bit, you know, and I resisted that. I just saw problems. So with the red flag said, don't get involved. This is going to be a nightmare. There's all kinds of like little messages that say, you know, beware, you know, be careful. And so like I had a lot of turmoil inside me, you know, because it's, you know, he had a sentence of 25 years to life. No matter what does that say to a woman? You know, what are you going to do? Take a tent and pitch it outside a prison for 25 years? I mean, that's just not even a realistic choice. So obviously the reality of the situation, I couldn't deal with. Over a period of time, I began to see that I wasn't really, you know, falling in love with somebody who was a prisoner. I was falling in love with someone who was a person, and he happened to be in that situation. And I saw that it wasn't a permanent situation, and I saw that as time went by, I began to see all the different things about his trials. I mean, I think his third trial in 1975 was a real eye-opener because it was such a circus. I mean, it was a melodrama. I mean, similar to soap operas in the afternoon, you know, in terms of various people strutting around and, you know, just getting, you know, calling shots that were reported in the media, you know, and it wasn't really a search for the truth. It was just something quite different. And I think that at that point, I saw the underlying unfairness, and then that added to just knowing Gary as a person, knowing what I know about Ulster County and the criminal justice system here in Ulster County. All those facts fit together, and it added up to a picture that I had to come to terms with. And of course, when he passed the polygraph test, I wasn't surprised at all. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really affirmed what we really believed.
The prison really puts pressures on relationships, okay? I came up through the standard American chauvinist upbringing, all right? And I had preconceived images of what people were and what male and female roles were, etc. And, you know, the relationship with Peg and the prison put so many pressures on it. That is, I had to trust. You know, when we made a commitment to each other, it was a heavy commitment to not to share ourselves with other people emotionally and in Peggy's case, sexually.
He didn't know I was seeing other men, and I didn't mention it to him, but I figured that's something that I should be doing. He was a friend of mine, and, you know, that was just my life on the outside. And one day I happened to let it slip, or he directly asked me. I think he probably pried it out of me. And he got very quiet, and he said, well, it's either him or me. And he got up and he left. And I didn't know that until later, that he went to complete anguish because he thought, now who am I? What do I have to offer her? I mean, here I am, I don't have anything. I'm a prisoner with a 25 to life sentence. And how can I expect her to make that kind of choice? And I went home, and what a question. I mean, what a thing to have put to you. And but I had to really come to terms with it at that point, and there was no question. That was who I wanted to be with.
Had you been married before?
Yeah, yeah.
So I guess from that experience, you figured you could manage one where you... you don't have to see him every day. Right?
I didn't think about anything. it was just kind of like, it was stepping into the unknown.
Yeah.
And
so was that an adventure?
Yeah, and it was kind of like he was also stepping into the unknown. And since New York has a state that doesn't permit prisoners with life sentences to marry, that was another obstacle we had to overcome because we really did make a choice that we wanted to be together.
So you changed that law?
No, we're still working on it. We've been working on that for 2 years now.
How do you survive from the minute you get up in the morning to the end of the day?
Well, I begin with deep breathing exercises. And,
you're in great shape.
Yeah, that puts you in touch with something very basic, breath, you know, life, and what sustains life. And I just get into the breathing, the inhaling and the exhaling. And and I begin the day with that slow pace and that recognition of... and then usually after the breath, I recognize the light and the sun. And some of the things that cannot be the walls do not affect. You know, the sun will come up every morning. You know, there will be fresh air, and there's some basic things in life like communication. So I get into these basic things, and then I begin the day. And it's usually a good in any situation. It was an experience I had on death row, and I was coming.
How long were you on death row, by the way?
3 years, around 33 months, yeah, around 33 months. And the first 18 months of the struggle there was like really, the environment was very hostile. I was angry because of the situation. I was on death row. This is before the case got reversed, and I got a new trial, but, it was kind of, the experience was one of madness. And the task before me was to make up some type of meaning in my life, right? And about 18 months into the struggle, I went out into the prison yard, and before that I mentioned I seen everything in a very, defined it in hostile terms, all right? Death row was there, they were keeping me there as a piece of meat, ready for the electric chair, and that's what their concern was, and my concern was about life and growth and straightening out the situation I was in. And I went out to the yard, and I used to curse people when I went out to the yard. And I didn't see too much, it was just a gravel floor. It was a 50-foot yard and with walls. And that's what I seen when I went out there. And one day I went out there, and I sat down. The butterfly came over the wall, right? And landed on my toe or something. And, I picked up on the butterfly. I looked at it, and then it, like, sort of flew over the wall. And when I lifted my head up, and I seen the sun, and there was a nice blue sky, and then I started breathing, and I got the summer scent in my lungs, right? And then I started digging that there's a whole universe, and I'm connected to it. I'm in a very small world, but there is a world beyond this world, and there is a universe out there, and there is a miracle and mystery about life. And it was like being born. It was like an awareness that came about. I came into that yard for 18 months and didn't recognize something that was there all the time. And then all of a sudden I walked in this day and I recognized that I had a choice of looking at the ground and the walls or the sky and the sun. And the choice happens to be, was based on my perception of life. And now I can walk into situations that are negative and I can find what's positive simply because my perception of life has changed. And it has a lot to do with my relationship with Peggy and people and the support, and it has a lot to do with trust, you know. And in a situation like this, you know, we talked about families before, and I got a new addition in the family. That is, I met Peggy while I was in prison, and you know, just a beautiful relationship developed. And it, when I say beautiful, I knew Peggy as a friend for years, and I respected her and admired her as a functional person and a friend. Before I even knew I was in love with her. Then, you know, I found out I was in love with her, you know, during the prison experience. It was a nice revelation. It was beautiful. But I had a multi-dimensional relationship. You know, I respected her on a lot of other levels other than just, you know, just a lover and a wife.
Well, we knew that if we went up to someone and said, can we get married, they would say no. So Gary probably had the best kept secret that was in Greenhaven at that time, and that was on a regular family day picnic. They have several of them in the summer. He worked, and other prisoners volunteered to give up their passes for that particular day, and Gary did it very quietly. He told the people that needed to be told, and a lot of our friends and our family came that day, and no one was aware that it was going to happen. We were, of course, and when people saw that it was happening, they quietly, you know, gave their support to us.
Is this what happened here?
Yeah, right there.
And somebody was able to erect a little tent and.
Yeah, those were.
Bring like amplifiers or musical instruments.
Yeah.
Can you see that, Tobe?
Yeah, I was going to show it separately.
Yeah.
So that must have been a surprise to the administration of the prison.
Oh, quite a surprise. Yes.
And all these people came as guests. Mm-hmm. To see Gary and you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, these are sheets that were sewn together right here.
In the prison?
In the prison, yeah.
Oh.
Okay, getting back to the original incident that's the basis for the case, all right? I was in Auburn prison, and I was traveling from Auburn prison to a court appearance in Westchester. And I was with my co-defendant and another prisoner. And during the ride from Auburn prison to the court, the other prisoner who had 29 years to do, he was about 30 years at the time, which meant he would probably be staying in prison for the rest of his life, made a break for freedom. And in the course of that, he shot and killed the deputy sheriff, and the deputy sheriff killed him. Now, the surviving deputy sheriff implicated myself and my co-defendant. In fact, he said that I did the shooting. So the basic issue here, the central issue here, is whether you believe me or you believe the deputy sheriff.
What was Gary in prison for at the time he was being transported down the thruway?
A gas station robbery.
How long before that?
About a year or so before the incident happened on the thruway.
Uh-huh.
He was 22. He's 36 now.
And what prison was he in, and where was he going?
He was going from Auburn to Westchester. He was being transported to be a witness in a court proceeding for his co-defendant, Charles Culhane. And that's why he was in the car. There was an appeal.
And he was going to go back to Auburn
after
the
testimony. Yeah, that's right. It was just a routine transport. There was no screen.
And his co-defendant was in the robbery.
Yes.
I see.
Yes.
And now he also has a co-defendant in this present case.
That's the same co-defendant.
He was also in the car?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I see.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And the car had no screen between the front and back seat. Today, no prisoner in the state of New York is transported without a screen. And I think that this is the case that forced the state to make that ruling, because obviously this is a crime that could never happen now,
mm-hmm.
and wouldn't have happened if there had been a screen in the car on that day.
So there were two deputies in front and three prisoners in the back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and no screen, and there was no, it was one of the deputies' private cars. There was no, radio or anything like that for communication. And it was just an escape waiting to happen, an escape attempt waiting to happen.
And Auburn is up by Syracuse, right? So it's at least a 5-6 hour car drive.
That right. And the person that actually did the shooting was Robert Bowerman. He had a long history, which is in his prison record, which didn't get introduced into the court in evidence. It's the one thing that the judge would not let in into court, of prior instances of trying to escape, grabbing officers' guns and things like that. So the jury never even heard this information. And so it was a matter of, you know, who do you believe, the deputy sheriff that testified or Gary? Now, Gary has taken 2 polygraph tests, and the deputy sheriff refuses to take a polygraph. So we have, you know, that basic, you know, like inequity also. And Bowerman, along the trip, kept asking to stop. You know, I have to go to the bathroom. And so they would pull on the side of the road. And they did this periodically. And it was one of those times when he asked, you know, the deputies to pull over, that that he leaned over the seat and the gun was grabbed and the shooting started. Mm-hmm. And it happened very quickly. Mm-hmm. It was like bam, 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 and, you know, shots going all over and smoke inside a little car. It was very traumatic for everybody involved. Sure. And for the deputy sheriff who survived, it was his best friend, you know. So, and, you know, like in the course of it, his glasses flew off. I mean, he was also driving the car at the
and
same time.
And he's the one who shot Bowerman?
Yes.
The one who survived?
No, the other deputy sheriff shot Bowerman.
And
yeah.
Bowerman shot.
Yes. Uh-huh. So there were 2 deaths in the car that day. And it was not only a tragedy that day, but it's been a continuing tragedy, you know, for years.
Right now, we have moved out of the legal arena. You know, it was a choice made by myself and Peggy, my wife. And we've moved out of the legal arena, and we've moved into the political arena, and we're asking Governor Carey to commute my sentence or to release me through the process of executive clemency, which is well within his power. And it's important for me, for my wife, for my family. The support from the community is important. In fact, my release depends on it, depends on whether people will write Governor Carey and urge his immediate action here. And the more support from individuals in the community and in groups in the community, the quicker this will happen. And of course, Peg and I are just committed to it. We're going to stay working and stay on top of it until the situation is resolved. But as I can't stress the importance enough for people to, if they're moved, to take that and write a letter and express that to the governor. And and again, as I mentioned, it's a community activity. That's the way it's going to happen.
Well, this is, I mean, saying that you're not going to eat anymore until he's released could be a terrifically dangerous for your health, couldn't it?
Well, I think it's uncomfortable, a little bit uncomfortable not to eat. It's a whole other way of living. I've never not eaten before. We're taking juices so that it's not a complete break from, you know, some kind of nourishment. But it's a whole different feeling. I have to say that it is. But I guess compared to all the pain and suffering that we've had to undergo for so many years, it's really nothing compared to that. And when you think about, like, my stomach hurts a little bit, you know, and it's uncomfortable, ordinarily I would kind of like go racing to the refrigerator. But no, it's kind of like you don't do that because you know that you're doing this for a real reason. And the reason is that is much more important than the temporary discomfort. And that's why it's not so bad, because we can't stand the other pain much more. That's much more significant. And it wasn't the decision that was taken lightly. Everyone made this decision voluntarily. And for a 71-year-old woman to make that decision, that's pretty strong. I mean, that's a statement on something that's really gotten out of control. This is really absurd, because we have really done everything that anybody can humanly do. our people have. We've gone out into the community, we've talked about the problem, we've gotten people concerned about it. Those people have gone to their representatives. The representatives have written, you know, have investigated the matter and have gotten behind it. We've had, you know, we've had clergymen come to our aid. We've had people in the prison system come. And after you do all of those things, and you do them again and again, at some point, when you get denied, you say that it just didn't work. What we're trying to do is getting Gary out. I mean, that's obviously the goal. There's other things that we're really talking about. And in that it's not just us. It's happening to a lot of people. And what we have to do is bring it to everybody's awareness. And that's what we're doing. And that's what the fast is about.
Hey, man, what are you doing? You're trying to start something. Look, I had one cigarette when I come in the cell, right? That's what I'm smoking now. I mean, what's the big deal?
The Night Owl Show, Fridays at midnight on Channel 6.
Buying Johnny Average Band records. Hi, Pat.
Good.
Are they selling like hotcakes? This could be a commercial for a shade of lipstick. Cantaloupe. So you must be very proud and happy about this.
I am.
It was a long, many years to get to this. So tell me about some of the heartaches and the passion that went into creating this.
Well, there actually was a whole lot, but I won't go into it.
Really? Oh, I would never have asked if I thought to.
No, it's.
But really, everybody knows it wasn't a breeze.
No, it was. It's a lot of fun, and I have a hard time taking it real serious.
Well, you never thought of yourself as a rock and roller.
No,
10 years ago.
I still don't. Basically, I'm not.
You're a scholar.
No. I'm a regular Joe, but it is fun and it is exciting, and I feel like I'm about 12 years old.
Tell me, all right, all 12-year-olds have fantasies.
What mine is out of this?
Yeah.
To tell you the truth, it is so that I hopefully can make some money to get a piece of land and a house that I can set up that doesn't have to plug into the whole network of have-tos, so I can have a house set up with givens, and
you mean like sunlight, water,
yeah.
And garden,
and
stuff like that.
And so I can stay home and have it just nice and comfortable and next to nature and all that stuff.
That's such a modest fantasy. It's so sweet.
No, but really, that's true.
So how long have you played guitar?
I don't.
What do you play?
I just sing. I play guitar and piano, but not when we play.
Well, when did you discover you could sing?
Well, I can tell you this one funny story. A group of people, we were talking about answer phones, and everybody had a different story of what happened with them in an answer phone. And I said, when I was in the fifth grade and my sister in the sixth grade, we lived near Disneyland, and they had a radio station, KEZY, and they had an answer phone. And my sister and I would write songs, hold the telephone upside down like a microphone, huddle close together, and sing songs into it. One was, give her a kiss, give her a hug, and wrap your lips around her. She'll be your baby, 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 all the time. Uh-huh. And we, when the beep came, and we would, like, watch the mailbox, because we were sure they were going to send us a contract. And so I told that story just in, that was my answer phone story. And somebody said, well, I'm glad to know you've been doing it that long. And it had never occurred to me that from then, which is the first beginning of me in music, till now, I had never put the two together in any way, shape, or form. So I guess somewhere there, I'd been wanting to do it from the get. You
so
know.
You're lucky that you stepped into it, too. Yeah. Could you introduce us to some other members of your band?
Yes, certainly I can. Shane Fontaine.
Shane Fontaine.
This is Hi. Shane Fontaine, Shane. Guitarist extraordinaire.
I must say that's a likely name.
A likely name.
Doesn't
likely.
His parents must have known when they named him Shane Fontaine
that
he would in fact become an extraordinary guitar player and fellow.
How long have you been playing the guitar, Shane?
I've been playing guitar since I was a little nipper.
I bet your father was a musician.
No, he wasn't.
No?
Wrong.
Well, tell us something about yourself.
Well,
when you were a little nipper.
When I was a little nipper, I was a devout Beatle fan. And that was the beginning of everything for me.
Now I'd like to know something about your fantasies.
My
fantasy now.
Oh, I better leave.
No, you can stay while I talk about my fantasies.
Do you have any gum?
Who are we speaking for?
Who are you speaking to?
To.
Speaking to people who would stay up late at night to see you.
Uh-huh. All right, fantasies.
I mean, no one's going to see you unless they want to, because this goes on very late at night.
Well, I'm just a regular guy.
No, I guess the question really has to do with the fact that here you have this real nice record, and it's selling like hotcakes. We can see him going like that across the through the cash register. So stardom is just around the corner, and I'd like to know what you're going to do with that.
Well, stardom is just around the corner. You hear that?
Does that sound good?
He just
or no?
came off the road on tour with Steve Forbert and.
Oh.
He's a little more experienced than the others of us in the band.
Uh-huh. So how long have you played the guitar?
The bass. The bass. For about 7-8 years.
So how long does a person have to play an instrument before they can join a band?
You can join immediately.
Without knowing the scales and the technique and even the tune?
You just have to start. Doing it. I mean,
I thought that was true.
Toby had a band once. It was a heavy metal band.
You did tell me.
And it was very loud. Toby was into loud music.
Frank and I are very good friends, by the way.
He's my mate.
He's who, a bit taller who backs than up who? Yeah.
Who backs up who? No, it's very equal, democratic lifestyle.
Am I holding this someone? I have to take off my coat.
Sure.
As a matter of fact, if you
it's beer.
Hi. Hi, Toby. Well, I have to kiss you.
On national TV. Now we're going to talk to, I think, we'll be talking to Griff McCree here, our manager.
Everybody else did it.
What did what?
Yes. To talk on TV.
Are you interviewing me?
Sure. Yeah.
I'll be back.
I'll talk to you later. Right. Here.
Get some interview signing.
I mean, this is not my gig, you know.
You can turn that mic over if you want, Frank. Really. How's it going, babe?
It's going fucking great.
It is. Okay.
That's for the record.
This is my wife. This is my lovely wife, folks.
This is my fine husband.
She's the best.
She's
the best
greatest.
Person in the world.
He really
we're just
is
like,
wonderful.
We just like everybody out there in video land to know
Marriage
how wonderful,
wonderful
this person really is. Cut. Yeah.
You sign my record, Mick?
Sure. No, you cut. It's Johnny. Sorry.
Don't cut just because he says so, Toby.
But this is true, right? We don't want no Mick on it, right?
I'm not kidding.
Is that your picture right here?
Sure.
Where was this taken, this picture?
In Los Angeles, in some real strange hotel.
Something like the Chelsea in New York.
Yeah,
that
sort
kind of
much worse than the Chelsea.
Well, the floor is clean as hell.
Well, they just painted it, that's why. Done in one week. Here you go. You got a pen? I got a pen. I'm going to sign my autograph for this wonderful lady. To, what's your name?
Mary.
Mary. To Mary. Love and kisses from Johnny. XXX. There you go. Oh, I'll keep my pen. Thanks.
So you feel good about the album?
Yeah, I do.
You have a favorite hit, song from it? But one cut?
I like pretty much everything on it. I think it's just a real solid album. It's a lot different than most people expected, which is real good, and it gets us out of the genre that we were locked into.
This is all original.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Not everyone thinks of this band as 50s, you know, so it's
cover versions and all that. So it's like, it's real good for everything.
There are no more of the Falcons? Is it always just the Johnny Average Band now?
Well, that's what they said New Year's Eve, so.
Yeah.
And I'm not working. So I guess it is. But it'll be good to go on the road, take it out, get out of the area.
When's that happening?
Still not sure. Maybe the end of February, March. Probably won't be till spring. I can't see a tour going out before then.
Where would you go? Where do you want to go?
I want to do Europe and Japan myself.
Is that in the cards?
I hope so.
Hi, Deb.
Hi, Tobe.
How you doing?
I
know
good.
We know that we can get good coffee from you folks over here in the corner, so we came over.
Good coffee.
Good coffee. You don't drink.
We're just having lots of fun.
Well, we're just staring at everyone. Yes, we're. What do you want to know?
What do you want to tell us? Tell us about this band.
Sex.
It's Woodstock, you know. Woodstock.
Wow. We'll come around a little closer.
Okay. Excuse me.
It's about the song, you know?
Hi, Nancy.
This song?
It's about this song? Have you heard this album before?
Yeah, I have heard it.
How many times?
A couple times.
Only a couple.
Yeah, only a couple.
Must have come just out then if you only heard it a couple of times.
Well, Frank brought it home and we listened to it at home. You know? I like it. Do you like it?
Well, it's the first time I've heard it, and I haven't been able to assimilate it.
This is not my favorite song on the album, though.
What is your favorite?
Well, I like Some People. I like Thermostat. I like Chi-Chi-Chiree. I like a lot of it.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What about you, Nance?
I like Public Image.
Which one?
Public Image. And the reggae stuff I like a lot.
So you like this? Is this off reggae?
This is sort of in its own category, sort of off. But I do like it.
When the tour goes out, are you going with it?
Well, I was thinking of disguising myself as a drum set.
You think you'll pass?
If I put on a few pounds.
Or take off a few pounds. Sticky. This is sticky.
I would love to go. I doubt if I ever will.
It's a nice party.
It looks like a nice party.
Yeah, it is
like
a nice party.
I haven't been able to party, but it sounds really good.
You want a glass of wine, Tobe?
I would love a glass of wine.
Okay.
Thanks. You know, we want to know, we really have to know what your favorite tune, if you have one.
My favorite tune?
Favorite tune on the album.
Andrew Birkensing.
Why is it your favorite? What's it have for it?
It's the guitar part.
Oh.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello. Oh, my favorite cut on this album.
On this album?
Oh, sorry.
Is there any other album?
Yeah, I think my favorite cut on this album, for me, would be, I don't know, there are so many. I love them all.
Uh-huh. Oh, that's good.
No, there's a lot which I do like.
Who wrote all the songs written by the same person?
No, Johnny had a hand in writing all of them, and he collaborated with Sid, his manager, and George, his engineer. Without this man,
greetings.
A lot more would have been possible.
Right.
What did he have
George
to do?
George is the engineer of the album.
Hi, George.
Hi.
And although he isn't actually credited with being one of the producers of the record, he actually did lend a very substantial hand in
for home broadcast?
Getting the whole thing off the ground. No, it's for Home Dirty Movies. Okay. Sorry, no, I didn't mean that.
This is for local, very local.
A very local?
Very local, yeah. You can say hello to any of your friends here in town.
I don't have any friends in town. Biff, how you doing, Biff? Biff, is Johnny over there?
That's about it.
Yeah. Well, that was George.
Have you talked to Don?
Thank you, George.
You gotta forgive his diction. He's from Philadelphia.
George, before you go away, I want to know, while you were producing this album, were there special problems that, that were different from another album, say?
They're all different.
Yeah, what was unique?
Johnny. Johnny was unique. No, not really. There's nothing unique.
Nothing unique.
Very straightforward. It was real union. Uh-huh. You know, it was a union job. We came in, we did it, it was done. That was it. There's nothing to it.
Interesting recording sessions for any reason or nothing?
Anything you do with Johnny and Nicole is interesting. I can say no more. Uh-huh. It will be interesting. You know?
Any good rock and roll parties?
No, we don't go in for that sort of thing. You know? It's just straight. Strictly just works. Strictly works. Work.
What about, you have a favorite cut on the album?
I like, What You Gonna Do When the Reggae Breaks Your Heart. That's my favorite song. Right now. I hate them all equally.
You've heard them a lot.
Yeah. Each song I probably heard about 700-800 times.
George, this is George.
Yes, we've been talking to George. We've been asking him about all the secrets of the studio and
secrets
how everything went
we
down.
We sleep together.
He said he had a hard time,
no,
a real hard
we
time.
Sleep together. No, we sleep together.
He gave you good press.
George,
he gave
George.
You good press.
Me and George and his wife and my girlfriend.
This is local, right?
Is that true? Is it true?
No. No. That's one thing about Johnny. He's also a habitual liar.
George.
That's a
Griff, what?
George.
What?
Nice. Brian.
Really nice.
Brian.
See, this is what happens.
Shane sleeps with me.
That's what you get paid for.
Shane also sleeps with me and George.
My hair's not good today.
Yeah.
My hair's not good today.
No, come on, Brian. Come on,
my hair's not good.
Brian.
You'll have to change your camera angle a bit to get Brian in the picture. Here he is.
Brian. Brian also sleeps with me, Shane, and George.
Brian is dead.
You hear the phone?
Your mother.
I think I heard the phone.
Stand with your back to the camera. We're telling me dead. Brian is dead.
What's the matter with Brian?
What's the matter with Brian?
He doesn't like his hairdo today.
His hairdo. Well, we'll only look at the back then.
No pictures.
Critics.
I like the album. It's nice.
How did you happen to hear about them? I mean, did you approach them, or did they approach you originally?
It didn't happen that way. There was, Mick was here to work with someone who's part of a band that was here, and then Nicole was living here, and it just sort of evolved out of...
It was sort of an organic thing.
Just sort of, yeah.
That's the nice thing about living in the country, where things can evolve organically, not so much in the city, where things are kind of thrown in your lap.
I don't know if there's any real difference in that sense between the city and the country. It's just that you get an opportunity to live a little different and feel a little different in the country.
Well, I just arrived. It seems like a nice little get-together party. It seems rather nice here. That's about all I can say.
So what are your rock and roll fantasies?
Just become a big star and make a lot of money and then, I don't know, like die when I'm 40, you know?
Die in a kind of special way?
In a limousine.
Yeah.
Or a swimming pool.
Yeah, a swimming pool would be nice.
A swimming pool with, yeah.
Yeah. Pat!
Yes.
How much did you take in tonight, kid?
I'm not sure yet.
A lot, right?
A lot, I hope, yes.
Pat Greenback.
I hope the record's really successful because they're good friends of ours. And
judging from this get-together tonight, I would say this is a big success.
I hope so. I really do. Yeah. They really deserve to be rich and famous.
If we could just launch them out in their limousine and in their yacht, huh? That would be great.
Ah, that'd be so good. They deserve it.
Dearest act, to one of my very favorite boys in town.
No, it just says boys.
Boys.
Right?
Love and kisses, your auntie, Nikki. Oh, that's nice. Did you write that?
No, Nicole wrote that.
What's the matter with me?
Don't wanna dance, but your feet just can't be still. Your head say you won't, but your hip won't.
Fridays at midnight on Channel 6.
Nice show. Oh. Nice show.
Good show.
You have the anthem
show.
Ready?
Cut out. Anthem. Ready?
I'll put okay. these, I'll put the top on the deck, so let's get out of here. I'm tired. Okay, good night, America. No.